thank you, Nancy and Joe, for inviting me and giving me the opportunity to give this talk. I would like to extend my thanks to the members of the local organizing committee for their kind assistance. So I am a solid earth geophysicist with a long-standing interest in data simulation. I have to say that I have really enjoyed the conference so far. Over the past few years, with a number of colleagues, we've been looking at the possibility of applying data simulation to terrestrial magnetism, and this is what I'm going to talk about today. The outline of my talk is the following. I will start with a rather lengthy introduction in order to present the observations that we have at hand, and also the motivation why we're trying to do that. And I will also show two examples of application. So, on this picture that I took from the European Space Agency, you see magnetic field lines in the vicinity of the Earth. So what you see that the field is predominantly dipolar, but that the field lines are also disturbed on the account of their interaction with the solar wind. So if we look more closely at what is an artist view of the Earth's magnetic field, we see that the field is originating, the field lines are originating from the center of the Earth. So to put it simply, the Earth's structure is that of a three-layer onion. You've got a solid mantle, which is made of silicate rocks, surrounding a fluid outer core, which is made of liquid iron, essentially, itself surrounding a solid inner core, which is essentially made of frozen iron. So it is precisely within the fluid outer core that the Earth's magnetic field is generated and sustained. There are convection currents flowing inside the outer core, currents of liquid metal, which generate electrical currents that sustain the Earth's magnetic field against resistive decay. So at the surface of the Earth, we live in a current-free region. And so we can describe the magnetic field as a potential field. So we write B equals minus grad V. And if we assume that the sources of the magnetic field are internal, that is underneath our feet, we can go back to Gauss's analysis from 1839, I think, and expand the magnetic potential into spherical harmonics. So the L here refers to the spherical harmonic degree. The M is the spherical harmonic order. And the GLM and HLM are called the Gauss coefficients. And so if we compute the radial component of the magnetic field based on this potential, we get this expression. And we see in particular that component of spherical harmonic degree L decreases like 1 over r to the L plus 2 as we go away, further away from its sources. In this expression, I should have said that A is a reference radius, that of the Earth. So in other words, if I look at the dipole component of the magnetic field, which corresponds to L equals 1, the axial dipole is the one that has L equals 1 and M equals 0, the dipole field decreases as 1 over r cubed. The next term in the expansion, the quadrupole, decreases as 1 over r to the fourth, and so on and so forth. And so as I increase the spherical harmonic degree, that is, as I go to smaller and smaller scales, then the geometric attenuation that I get when I go further and further away from the core becomes more and more dramatic. So that's something that we must keep in mind in the following. So I can use potential theory in particular, to express the sensitivity of a pointwise measurement that I could make at the surface of the Earth to the structure of the magnetic field at the top of the source region, that is, the top of the core. To do that, I need to assume that in between myself and the core, the medium is insulating, which is a fairly good approximation for the mantle because mantle rocks are poor electrical conductors. So I can come up with an analytical expression to express the sensitivity of the measurement of any component of the magnetic field vector here to the structure of the field at the core mantle boundary. And so in particular, if I were to measure the vertical component of the magnetic field here in COBE, the region that I would be sampling at the top of the core would be essentially this red region here. Okay, so the measurement that I would make here would be a weighted average, if you will, of the magnetic field structure at the top of the core. So, in principle, if I have a collection of such measurements properly distributed at the surface of the Earth, then I can do a proper job of describing exactly what the structure of the field at the top of the dynamo region, that is, at the top of the core, should be. I cannot say anything about what's happening inside the core, because inside the core there are electrical currents. I cannot use potential theory, and I need to resort to other means to say something about the internal structure of the core. And so what I said is just in principle, because the bad news, as far as you are, if you are interested in the core field, the bad news is that the Earth's crust, that is a thin layer just underneath our surface, is magnetized as well. So this is the magnetic field of the Earth's crust. So it's a small-scale field. It's relatively of small amplitude when you compare its value with the value of the dipole field that generated by the dynamo. But because of this dramatic geometrical attenuation of the small scale of the core field, which I discussed before, what happens is that this small-scale lithospheric field conceals the small scales of the dynamo field. Okay, so you can only have a large wavelength view of the Earth's magnetic field at the top of the dynamo regions. And so the take-home message from this first slide is that the field at the surface of the Earth is dipole-dominated. There are small scales in the dynamo field generated inside the core, but I can't see them because they are concealed from the small scales of the crustal field. That's on the account of the dramatic geometric attenuation that they undergo as I go from the surface of the core to the surface of the Earth. Even if I had a perfect sampling of measurements at the surface of the Earth, I cannot go beyond spherical harmonic degree 13 when I want to describe the field at the surface of the core. So this corresponds to a lateral resolution of about 1,500 kilometers at the core surface. So this is an intrinsic limit of the knowledge that I can have based on observations on the structure of the field at the top of the core. So I'm now going to review the data that we have at our disposal to study the Earth's magnetic field. So this is a vector, so we need three independent components to describe it properly. So modern measurements consist of the X, Y, and Z component of the magnetic field. X is a component that's pointing towards the true north. Y is the east component, and Z is a downward pointing component. So such measurements are currently provided by satellites, low Earth orbiting satellites. So we've had satellites for about 20 years now. We also have a network of observatories that were essentially deployed after Gauss's analysis. So we've got about 150 years of data. And it's important to contrast these values for the time span with timescales of the dynamo process occurring in the core. One important time scale is the convective turnover time, which happens to be on the order of 150 years. Okay. One other important time scale is the magnetic diffusion time. That is the time it would take for the dynamo to decay to zero if I were to shut it down. So these are important time scales, and clearly these time scales are telling me that I need more longer time series if I want to say more about the dynamics of the field. And so one possibility is to go into logbooks from mariners, because there I will find directional information about the magnetic field, D and I. D is called the declination. This is the angle between true north and the magnetic north. I is the inclination. It's the angle between the horizontal component of the magnetic field and the magnetic field itself. If I want to access even longer timescales, I can analyze indirect measurements, which come from the magnetization that was acquired by some materials when they cooled below the Curie temperature. So these materials can either be igneous rocks, lava flows; they can consist of sedimentary rocks; And they can also consist of archaeological artifacts. And so, that concerns the disciplines of paleo and archaeomagnetism, which give me access to wider timescales of several tens to hundreds to thousands of kilo years in the past. And for these indirect measurements, I have also DNI, but I can also access via proper lab measurements to the norm of the magnetic field vector, which is denoted by F and is also called the intensity. So this situation in terms of the spatial temporal distribution of data is to be contrasted with their spatial distribution. So it's typically the distribution that you get for archaeo and paleomagnetic data. So very uneven distribution in space at the surface of the Earth. For instance, here you've got an idea of the distribution of data over the past 10,000 years or so. This is what you get typically for data coverage when you look at logbooks. Observatories are mostly located on land. And of course, you get excellent coverage with satellites, but again, at the expense of a limited time span. And so if we want to sort of summarize the situation, we see that as we go from paleomagnetic and archaeomagnetic data towards more recent satellite data, we can possibly have access to finer and finer structures as regards the geodynamo, but that is at the expense of a limited number of time scales that we can actually resolve. And so we know that all these different databases must be related to each other via physical processes. And so it's precisely one of the motivations to use data assimilation is to try to see whether we can use all this data together by relating them with numerical model. And so in data assimilation for geomagnetism, our goal is to analyze the variations of the geomagnetic field reflected by this highly heterogeneous record using a dynamical model of the field evolution as source of prior information. Okay, so as usual, we need two ingredients, observations, which are already discussed, and physical zones, which come in the form of a dynamical model. So the goals are several. We want to identify the processes that are the origin of the geomagnetic secular variation, as it's called. So that's an important question because it's a fundamental question. We want to estimate, to be in a position to estimate the internal magneto-hydrodynamic structure of the core. We want to be able to be in a position at some point to forecast the evolution of the geomagnetic field, and we also want to be in a position to reanalyze its past variations. And so, two applications that I want to present in the following. I have to say that we are far from being operational yet. We are more at the research stage, at the feasibility stage. I'm going to show two applications. The first application has to do with the assimilation of archaeomagnetic data into a three-dimensional numerical model of the geodynamo. So using data covering 3,000 years. And then second example is the one of the assimilation of dipole intensity data. So essentially a time series spanning the past 2 million years into this time, a low-dimensional model of geomagnetic reversals. So the first application essentially follows from Sabrina Sanchez's PhD, which she defended last year. And so we'll first give you a brief overview of what the numerical model of the geodynamo does. So dynamo is a system which has the capability of converting mechanical energy into electromagnetic energy. So as I said before, in the core of the Earth, it's convective flow of liquid iron, which sustains the field against ohmic decay. So model of the geodynamo is simply a numerical model where you conserve mass, momentum, and energy, and you also satisfy Maxwell's equations, okay, which you write under the magneto-hydrodynamic approximation. That means that you filter out light waves. So you get a set of three-dimensional nonlinear coupled partial differential equations that you need to solve in a spherical shell, which is the geometry of the fluid outer core. So typically, we do that using a pseudo-spectral method that was pioneered by Glassmeyer in the 1980s. And in our case, we use spherical harmonics in the horizontal direction together with finite difference in radius. And the size of the state vector in the things that we do is typically between 10 to the 6 and 10 to the 7. So the ensemble Kalman filter that we built in our group is based on the starting dynamo code, which is an in-house code, modified in-house code, which I made modular, and which is also resorting to a very fast and efficient spherical harmonic transform library, which is called the SHTNS, that was developed by Nathanael Schaeffer. The ENKF layer is coming from a suitably modified version of the parallel data simulation framework PDAF of Nerger and Hiller, whose principle is illustrated on this chart here. I say suitably modified version because I had to modify it in order to account for the fact that our state vector is complex valued because we are using complex valued spherical harmonics. So we had to do a little bit of modification there. And so we end up with, typically in our application, we use between 1,000 and 2,000 cores, so it's not that large an application, and because it's the ENKF, we get a very good parallel efficiency. It's larger than 99% on 1,500 cores or so. So the data that we assimilated in this preliminary work are distributed like that in time. So going from approximately 1,000 BC to 2000 AD, we're looking at archimagnetic data, that is data of declination, inclination, and intensity, whose distribution is highly variable in time. In the first attempts that we ran using these pointwise measurements, we performed one analysis every 20 years, keeping in mind that the numerical time step in our model is on the order of 2 days. And we took an ensemble size equal to 512. So when we carried out twin experiments, things were working smoothly, but we got a little bit into trouble when we started to assimilate real data. That's what I want to comment upon now. So it turns out that, so that's typically a data distribution at some point in time in the assimilation. So it turns out that the database contains data whose locations are kind of close at the surface of the Earth, but whose values are, I wrote, moderately compatible with each other, not to write incompatible. So for instance, that we'd get a declination equal to minus 20 degrees here and 20 degrees there. So very sharp gradient in declination at the surface of the Earth. So even though the field that you map at the surface of the Earth can look relatively smooth, because again, we are far from the source, so we get a smooth image of the dynamo. In particular, here I'm plotting the intensity, which is large, so the magnitude of the field, which is large near the pole, and is considerably weak in this region there, which is called the South Atlantic magnetic anomaly. Even though it looks smooth at the surface, when I look at things at the top of the dynamo region, at the top of the core, then I get very strong gradients in BR, in the radial component of the field. And that led, in our case, to an unstable scheme. It would simply blow up. So we came up, that's work in progress, with an empirical fix, not to say a quick and dirty fix, to have the code run. What we did was we took each component of degree L of each state vector and multiplied it by a scaling factor depending on the spherical harmonic degree, equal to 1 if the spherical harmonic degree is smaller or equal to 5, and going like 1 over L squared for spherical harmonic degrees larger than 5. So we're kind of smoothing. We are Hilbert space regularizing. Yeah, well, it's got an empirical touch to it anyway. So that allowed us to have a first complete data assimilation run. So for instance, this is the variance of the ensemble as a function of time between, again, 1000 BC and 2000 AD. So you see that approximately after 1500 years, you start of stabilize your system. We can also look, for instance, at how the coefficient for the axial dipole is varying as a function of time. So this is the ensemble of G10, because that's how it's called. So this is G10 expressed in its unit, microtesla, again going from 1000 BC to 2000 AD. And so what the ensemble is showing is that towards more recent epochs, in particular for the past 200 years, so G10 increases, but G10 is negative. So the magnitude of the dipole, which is the main contributor to the field, is decreasing. So this decrease in absolute value has led some of my colleagues and also some journalists to speculate that we may be entering a stage where we will eventually cross the zero line and the field may eventually reverse. So this is what I'm going to talk about now from another perspective. So we are now looking at a simpler problem. We're going to look at the assimilation of dipole intensity data over a much longer time span, 2 million years, and we're going to use a low-dimensional model of geomagnetic reversals. So that's the second application. That's work that we did with Matthias Morsfeld and Gauthier Hulot. And so the idea here, and I took that from a movie that came something like 15 years ago. So I wanted to take the Japanese poster. So I don't know what's written here, but I hope it's okay. So in this movie, the magnetic field of the Earth is becoming weaker and weaker. So that doesn't go without consequences, for instance, on the Coliseum here or the Golden Gate Bridge there. And so your average good-looking geophysics professor, played here by Aaron Eckhart, comes up with a solution. That is to send a nuclear head inside the Earth down to the boundary between the inner core and the outer core just to restart the dynamo. So I won't tell you what happens next because I don't want to spoil. And so I encourage you to watch this movie, which is kind of interesting. And I'm getting back to my assimilation problem. So the data that we are looking at right now is the data showing the signed relative paleointensity, essentially G10, if you will, as a function of time for the past 2 million years this time, okay? Zero is today, and that is 2 million years ago. So the blue curve is a compilation that was made based on sedimentary rocks. It's called the SIN 2000 data, and the light blue cloud, it's its standard deviation. The red curve is another compilation that was that corresponds to the PADM 2M model. So we've got one datum every 1,000 years, and it's important to see that every once in a while we cross the zero line, and we do that 7 times over the past 2 million years. We see on this curve also that the last reversal occurred something like 800,000 years ago. So we're going to try and assimilate this time series, and we are going to use a low-dimensional deterministic model of dipole reversals that was proposed by Giesinger a few years ago. That's a variation of on Lorentz 1963 model. So you've got three state variables. D is a dipole. So this is what is observed, and this can reverse or change sign. Q is another magnetic variable. Let's call it the quadrupole. And V is a flow variable. So if you properly calibrate the control parameters mu, nu, and gamma, your dipole variable can navigate between two attractors, which corresponds to a given polarity. So it's typically, the time series that you get looks like this. And this is the basis of our assimilation experiment. So with Matthias, we tried different techniques. I will skip on the details because in the interest of time, we looked at the ENKF and we looked at implicit sampling, which is really Matthias' thing. And so we ended up choosing implicit sampling, and the best setups that we came up with implicit sampling using 5 points per sweep. So that is time windows of 4 kilo years, because we have one datum every 1 kilo year, and 400 samples. Okay, so this is the setup that we retain for the assimilation. So we looked at how we could encast the last reversal, for instance. So we are looking at the sample trajectory in purple. Blue is the data. So we see that, in the data, the reversal occurs something like 777 and 776 kilo years ago. So if we look at the trajectory of the particles more than 4,000 years before this, and no sample is predicting a reversal within the next 4 kilo years. If we now look at what happens right before the reversal, then 94% of the particles predict a reversal. And if we go beyond that, then we see that the no sample predict a reversal, but at the same time, we see that there is an unwanted behavior that tends to drag or bring the particles back to the zero line. So we can actually quantify that and look at the probability for a reversal to occur within the next 4 kilo years over the entire length of the record. So we just look into in details into this situation there. But we see that the method is capable fairly well of accounting for the reversals that happened in the past. And so the good news from our perspective is that we are not triggering any alert here toward the end of the interval. Okay, so there's no reversal insight. So to summarize some aspects of data assimilation in geomagnetism, so two applications. We've applied the ENKF to a full dynamo model, and we wanted to assimilate pointwise our geomagnetic observations spanning the past 3,000 years. So far, we came up with some empirical fix to cope with the heterogeneity within the data set. So we need to be more systematic, particularly regarding the size of the ensemble, data selection, and so on and so forth. The overarching goal of this is to combine this archaeomagnetic data with the more accurate and recent historical and satellite data. And we are thinking of doing that in the framework of the ensemble Kalman smoother. And then at the end, we'll be able to predict under uncertainty the evolution of the structure of the field. Regarding low-dimensional modeling of geomagnetic reversals, well, within our framework, there's no reversal insight. We can do a better job in improving the low-dimensional models. We can, and there's also good news from the observation in the sense that longer paleo-intensity records are currently being built, which will provide us data spanning not 2 but 5 million years in the past. So I leave you with this positive note. Thank you.